My title tonight is From Logic to Anthropology. I think that the fundamental problem in the philosophical field today is to find something like a new logic. We cannot today begin by some considerations about politics, life, creation, or action. We cannot find in all that a true beginning for philosophy. We must first describe a new logic, a new way of thinking, and finally, a new definition of philosophy itself. More precisely, we must find a new dialectics. I think there have been two fundamental stages in the history of dialectics. First, dialectics in the sense of Plato, and after that, the dialectics in the sense of Hegel. The time, our time, is the time for the third stage. The invention, maybe the collective invention, as always, of a new dialectics. After all, it's also the way Marx had proposed after Hegel. The work of Marx is not first a new historical vision, a new theory of class struggle, and so on. But from its very beginning, it's a new general logic in the wake of Hegelian dialectics. Marx was perhaps the first, maybe after Plato, to create an explicit relation between new politics, revolutionary politics, and a new dialectical framework. The way of Plato is finally also from logic to anthropology and politics. And the way of Marx has been also, in fact, from logic, dialectical logic, from Hegel to revolutionary politics. We have the same problem today with other problems, naturally. To be sure, we have to rectify many things after two centuries of successes and dramatic failures in revolutionary politics, and in particular, after the dramatic failure of the state form of socialism. But we also have to find a new logic, a new philosophical proposition adequate for all forms of creative novelty. And so the question of dialectical and non-dialectical relations is a pressing difficulty. If you want, our problem today is the problem of negativity, the problem of the strength of negativity. When the logical framework of political action, and political action is only a sample, when the framework of political action is the framework of the classical dialectical type, what is fundamental you know that is negation. The development of the political struggle is fundamentally something like revolt against, opposition to, negation of. And the newness, the creation of the new state, or the creation of the new law, is always a result of the process of negation. This is the political form of Hegelian framework. You have a relation between affirmation and negation, construction and negation, in which the real principle of movement and the real principle of creation is in fact negation. And so the very definition of the revolutionary class, for example, is to be against the present state, the present law. And the revolutionary consciousness, as Lenin would say, is basically the consciousness that one stands in relation of negation to the existing order. I think that this vision, as such, cannot be sustained today. We are living a sort of crisis of the trust in the power of negativity. And we classically know two great forms of this crisis. This crisis of the conviction that there is a possible creativity in negation as such. Adorno, for example, thinks that the classical Hegelian dialectics was too much affirmative, too much submitted to the potency of the totality and of the one. He proposes, to go beyond the crisis of negativity, a sort of hyper-negativity, the name of which is negative dialectics. We know today, I cannot prove all that immediately, but we know today that in this way, the way of negative dialectics, we have finally nothing else than an ethics of compassion. A vision where the hero of our consciousness is the suffering human body, the pure victim. And we know also that this morality of the victim is perfectly adequate to the capitalist domination under the mask of democracy. On the other side, another attempt to go beyond the crisis of negativity, Negri, but also in some sense Althusser, which is a paradoxical conjunction, but a real conjunction, think that Hegelian dialectics was too much negative, too much subjective, and too much indifferent to the potency of nature, of life, of the movement of history. They find in Spinoza a model of philosophy which is finally without negation. And it has been, in some sense, Spinoza against Hegel. We know today that in this way purely affirmative, we have finally a sort of acceptation of the dominant order across the conviction that this order is full of affirmative newness and creativity. It's bad, but it's the movement of life itself. And that finally, modern capitalism is the immediate strength which works beyond the empire and beyond negativity in the direction of a sort of new communism. What I search in all my work is to propose a new dialectical framework, which is a common project with Adorno, Negri, Althusser, and so on. A new dialectical framework which is not a return to the young Marx or to Hegel, but which is neither the negative dialectics of Adorno, which is something like the aesthetics of human rights, nor the affirmative construction of Negri, which destroys all forms of dialecticity and is, in my opinion, like Nietzschean gay savoir of history. I think the problem today is to find a way of reversing the classical dialectical logic inside itself, so that the affirmation or the positive proposition comes before the negation, instead or after it. Or in some sense, my attempt is to find a dialectical framework where something of the future comes before the negative present. I am not suggesting the suppression of the relation between affirmation and negation. Certainly, revolt and class struggle remain essential, and critique of the past too, like critique of old forms in artistic creation. All that is a necessity. I am not suggesting a pacifistic direction, some general peace, affirmative quietness. Something like that. The question is not whether we need to struggle or oppose. Certainly we need. The question concerns more precisely the relation, the precise relation between negation and affirmation. So in my work, I search some traces of something outside the classical dialectics, but which is dialectics in some sense. It's a case when I write about Paul, about Wagner, about love, about mathematics, or about the field of concrete political analysis. Formally, in all that, it's the same idea. We have to try to understand exactly the conditions under which we may still have anything like the possibility of concrete negation. And I believe this can only be realized in the field of primitive affirmation, through something that is primitively affirmative and not negative. And it's a question of event and subject in my terminology. Ultimately, I am saying something very simple. My master Althusser, after all, he has been my master too, was accustomed to say that philosophy must be as simple as the hand, as nude as the hand. I think there is something true. And so I attempt to say something very simple. I am saying first that to open a new situation, a new possibility, we must have something like a new creativity of time, in time, and a new creativity inside the situation. You must have something that is really an opening. And I name this opening event. What is an event? An event is simply that which interrupts the law, the rules, the structure of the situation, and creates a new possibility. So an event is not initially the creation of a new situation, the creation of a new world. An event is the creation of a new possibility of a new world, which is not the same thing. In fact, the event takes place in a situation that remains the same, but the same situation can be seen and can be transformed inside the new possibility. For example, for Paul, to return to this ancient book, we know that the event is the resurrection of Christ. And this event does not directly change anything in the Roman Empire. So the general situation, which is the Roman Empire, remains the same. But inside the situation, by the event, there is the creation and the opening of a new possibility for the life and the conviction of people. In the political field, it is the same thing. In Paris, in May 68 of the last century, there is no real change. There is certainly an event, but there is no real change in the general situation of the state. De Gaulle remained in power, and the government was still functional with its police and so on. But there was an opening for a new possibility, by the way, of new forms of political action. And this is what I call an event. After that, there is the possibility of the materialization of the consequences of this new possibility and the elaboration of these consequences is the creation of what I name a new subjective body. A new subjective body. So a new thing inside the situation as a consequence of the evental rupture. A new subjective body is the realization of the possibility that is opened by the event in a concrete form and which develops some consequences of the new possibility. Naturally, among these consequences, there are different forms of negation. We find, finally, negation. Struggle, revolt, a new possibility to be against something, destruction of some part of the law, and so on. But these forms of negation are consequences of the birth of the new subjectivity and not the other way around. It's not the new subjectivity that is a consequence of the negation. So, there is something really non-dialectical in the sense of Hegel or Marx about this logic. Because we do not start with the creativity of negation as such, even if the site of negativity is certainly included in the consequences of something, but of something which is affirmative. I can return on this point to the book concerning Paul. This book was written, ultimately, to propose a clear example of this new logic. That is, a new logic for all truth procedures, not only political action, but artistic creation, life in love, and so on. Paul offers a very clear and, in some sense, mythologic example of how to think the relation between an event and a new subjectivity, which is the very center of the point. And this was my main point. Paul provides a new and very acute perspective on how this logic operates in the field of law, and specifically in the relation of the new subject to the old law. And in a very explicit manner, Paul explains that when you have an event that is really the creation of a new possibility in the situation, one must first create a new body and affirm a new subjectivity before all negation and all negative consequences. The first thing is to create, to affirm the new subjectivity. What then is at the very beginning of a new subjectivity and of the new subjective body? In the case of Paul, it is the group of people who affirm that there is really a new possibility. So at the beginning, the question is to affirm the affirmation. Not to negate, but to affirm the affirmation. In the case of the Christianity, they affirm the resurrection. After that, there are a lot of practical and symbolic consequences in all the situations. But it is interesting to see in the example of Paul that the very beginning of something new is always something like a pure affirmation of the new possibility as such. There is a resurrection, you have to affirm that. True or false, it's another problem. Another problem in the condition of Paul. And when you affirm the resurrection and you organize that sort of affirmation, because affirmation is always with others and in the direction of others, you create something absolutely new, not in the form of a negation of what exists, but in the form of the newness inside of what exists. And so there is no longer negation on the one hand and affirmation on the other. There is rather affirmation and division, or the creation that grounds the independence of the new subject from within the situation of the old. This is the general orientation of the new logic. In this orientation, we can propose a new examination of all the old words in some field of knowledge or action. As an exercise, I propose to discuss the word democracy. Today, democracy is really the common term of all the ideological disposition of the states, or pretty much all the reactionary states, in fact. Therefore, we must declare a first rupture by saying that we don't accept that sort of ideological line, which ultimately amounts to the idea that one can resist their democracy without being a terrorist, an ally of despotism, and so forth. Okay. But how we can do that? How we can really create a new way to critique the false democratic order? We are in a situation where we have to clarify for ourselves not only the content of the concept, democracy in the case, but also whether we want to use the word. Is there today a possible good use of the word democracy? There is today a possibility to affirm democracy in the framework of affirmative dialectics. That is my subjective question. There can be both good and bad uses of the word democracy, after all. So the subjective question is how we can be sure of the existence of a really affirmative vision of what is democracy today. We can decide to keep the word. And it's my position. It's better to keep the word. It's generally a good thing to keep the word. Because there is something problematic about some leftist saying, I am not interested in democracy at all because it has become practically meaningless. It's true, but it's true also that when you talk about democracy, you are always participating on the terrain of the common ideology. The critique is with meaning. And the situation is difficult because precisely we cannot have simply the new mean to criticize the word democracy in the framework of affirmative dialectics. To negate is very simple. We can say this democracy is certainly a false democracy. But the question is not the negation. The question is to inscribe democracy in the new affirmative framework. It's another question. It's a true political question. It is probably too easy to say, okay, yes, we are in a democracy, but democracy can do something else. To say, I negate the actual sense of democracy, and I create, by negation, another sense to the world. Finally, if you say, yes, we are in democracy, but it's not the true democracy, you are in a defensive position. You are, as you will be, the true defender of democracy. And it's the opposite of my conception, because my position is to begin by affirmation, and not at all by a defensive position. So we cannot will only be in a defensive position, true democracy against false democracy, dominant false democracy. So, finally, we can take another way and distinguish two forms of positive democracy. For example, and it's classic, we can distinguish popular democracy from bourgeois democracy, or perhaps, to be more contemporary, popular democracy from yuppie democracy. And the possibility of that sort of division is also the possibility of thinking democracy as something other than a pure form of state. It is a distinction not only between popular democracy and yuppie democracy, but between true democracy and democracy as a form of state, as a form of power, as a form of oppressive state or as a form of a class state. That is, all that is a classical discussion. But, you know, the point is today that this strict duality is not convincing in the framework of a new dialectical thinking. It's too easy to determine negatively the popular democracy as being all that the state democracy is not. To escape that sort of game of negation and negation of negation, I now present not two understandings of democracy, not a division in two, but in three. And very often, the passage of a dialectical, classical dialectic framework to new dialectic framework is a passage from two to three, or sometimes from three to four. We can see that after. So that is a sort of trick, in fact. When you are in difficulty with the division in two, you create a division in three. And it is why, generally, because it's my trick, it is why, generally, as Agamben was the first to remark here, some years ago, I have finally, for every problem, four terms. I am the new dialectical framework is also the creation of something which finally is composed of four terms. And Hegel, as you know, has three terms. Because concerning the active process, because after the negation, which is the first movement of the Hegelian dialectic, and the negation of negation, which is the second great movement, Hegel has the totality of the process, inclusive of negation and negation of negation, as finally a third term. But in the new framework that I propose, we cannot have something like that because we have not negation as the first term, negation of negation as the second term, and finally the incorporation of all that in the absolute process. I begin, in fact, by two different affirmations, the reactive one and the new one. And the new affirmation, if we begin by an affirmation, is not the negation of the first affirmation. It's something which is affirmatively new and which is not constructed by pure negation of what exists. So we begin with two affirmations. And so we have the possibility of two negations, the negation of the first term by the second term, or the negation of the second term by the first. So revolutionary action and counter-revolutionary action. But the point is that the conservative negation of novelty, the first negation, cannot be the same that the negation by the new of the conservative position. You know, a new affirmation is not new if its negation of the old world is absolutely the same negation that the negation of the novelty by the old world. Or if the reactive negation is the same thing that the affirmative negation, finally we have a pure symmetry between the old world and the new world, and we have no real novelty. So finally, we have two affirmations at the beginning, and we have also two different negations. It's the point is very important, because in fact, during all the last century, the point is that the negative action of the revolutionary state is in the same form that the oppressive negation of the old state. And so by the negation, we have the construction of a symmetry, a new oppressive state in place of the old oppressive state. And the point is that we are in a dialectical framework in the old manner. If we begin with affirmation, we open to negation at the second term and not at the first, but this negation must be different from the reactive negation of your enemy. And so finally, two affirmations and two negations. Donc you have by necessity four terms, four different terms as a complete intelligibility of the dialectical framework. Alors, I can give, it's a continuation of the exercise, the three primitive terms, the dialectical classical terms in the question of democracy. First, there is democracy as a form of state, which is really democracy in its commonplace meaning, that is, representative democracy, parliamentarian ideology, and so modern existence of the state. Secondly, there is democracy understood as movement, not at all as state, but as movement, a sort of mass democracy, which probably is democracy not directly in the political sense, but much more in the historical sense. Something like a birth of the new in a democratic form, like the Arab Spring, if you want. We have democracy, mass democracy, but in a form which is not the form of the power or the state or something like that, but is the form of the uprising itself. When that sort of democracy takes place, it's democracy in the form of an event, much more than in the form of a political process, it's a form of an event, an historical event, which is the revolt itself. This is the sense of democracy in the work of Jacques Rancière, for example, clearly, the second sense of democracy. And it is why, for Rancière, democracy exists only, true democracy exists only from time to time. It's not a state of affair, democracy. It's something which happens. So we have democracy sometimes, but not very often, finally. And it's normal if democracy is the name of an exceptional situation concerning the people. What Rancière says, which is really interesting, is that sort of democracy is, in fact, the activation of the principle of equality. So it's not at all a question of organization of the power or the state. It's not a question of organization of the society, finally. It's the internal law of a collective event. When we have a collective event, the internal law of the collective event is to active some principle of equality. And when the principle of equality is really active, you have some version of our understanding of democracy, that is, democracy as the irruption of collective equality in a concrete form, which can be protest, insurrection, popular assembly, or any other form in which equality is effectively active. So this understanding itself has many forms, but we can perfectly understand precisely what this form of democracy is, and it's in fact a recurrent form of revolutionary democracy. But it's much more a form of sudden emergence in history and ultimately in the form of an event than in the form of the consequences of the event or of the creation of the new political body, you know. In the moment of revolutionary rupture, we have a true meaning of democracy, mass democracy, but it's not exactly the political concept of democracy. This is why I propose to say that it's much more the historical definition of democracy than its political definition. And so we have to find a third sense of democracy. We have not to be enclosed in the pure opposition between popular democracy or mass democracy and democracy as a form of state. In the new framework, dialectical framework, we must find a third sense of democracy, which is properly the democracy of the determination of the new political subject as such. The new political subject as in the consequences of the event, and not only in the event as such. And this is my ultimate conception. Democracy at this level is a name for the elaboration of the consequences of collective action and for determining a new political subject. So finally, we have three terms in appearance. Democracy as a form of state, first affirmation. Democracy as a mass democracy, which is the second affirmation. And after that, we have the collective action, the determination of the consequences of the event as the emergence of a new political subject. But in fact, we have a fourth term, finally. Because after the classical representative democracy, which is a form of the state power, after mass democracy, which is of historical nature, after democracy as a political subject, we have, as in Hegel, the process of all that returning to the first term, returning to the state, precisely. Or what is the democratic process when it is returning to the first term? Is necessarily the possibility of a declining of the state itself, in the term of Marx himself. It's the possibility, the horizon of the progressive disparition of the state as a central necessity, as a form of power. So the fourth term is the three first terms when they return to the first, the state, in the vision of, in the communist vision, for the case, of the vanishing of the state, of the historical process of the progressive disparition of the first term. And this is why we have, in fact, four terms in this example of the new dialectical framework. So we substitute to the clear classical opposition between the dominant false democracy and the true popular democracy a sort of complex with three places: state, revolutionary event, and politics. Three processes: affirmation of the people's access to politics outside the state, negation of this access by the state, and possible victory of the political organization of people. And as a totalization of the complete complex, we have what I can name a point of communism by the concrete results of all that, results which are proofs, small proofs or big proofs, of the weakness of the state. of the weakness of the first stage, and finally, of the possibility of its declining. Another sample is precisely the relationship between politics and power. More generally, not in the form of the democratic term. Classically, the goal of political action is to seize the power, to destroy the state machinery of the enemies. The name of all that is the master name of all political classicism. It's the name revolution. Revolution is probably, in the political field, the most important name of the classical dialectics, because it's the name for negativity itself. Revolution is first the destruction, the possible destruction of the state of the enemies, and after that, the creation of a new state, or finally, the creation of condition of vanishing of the state. But first, we have, by revolution, the destruction of the state. Today, I think, we cannot have a simple use of the word revolution. Because if we assume the word revolution in this classical sense, we return to the beginning by negation. So we return to the classical dialectics. The word revolution cannot be our master name. So we have to be entirely on the outside of state power, not only in the action, which naturally is not the action of the state, because it's the action of a new political subject, but also as a goal. We must affirm that our goal is not by itself the state, the size of the power, of the state power. So we have to be entirely, in some sense, outside of state power, subjectively, but we know that the state is always in the field of political questions and in the space of action. If our political subjectivity is not inside the state, inside the common law, and so on, if, to the contrary, it is on the outside of the state is nonetheless in the field of every political action today. To take a concrete example from some of my direct experience, suppose we have to do something about workers who are without papers, who are undocumented workers. Say, the African immigrants in France. And we want to organize and to change things in this field. We want that it was possible for African immigrants, for workers, which are here sometimes for many years, to have papers. We want something like that. We want that African immigrants can live with us, as us. We will quickly find that the state is in our space. We will have to confront new laws and decisions of the state. And we will have to create something, some new form of organization, that will be face to face with the state. Not inside the state, but face to face with it. So we will have a discussion with the state or we will organize various forms of disruption. In any case, we have to prescribe something about the state from outside the state. Understand? We will have to prescribe something that establishes a relation with the state, but not a relation in the state. And the big difficulty, and it's really the big difficulty of politics in the dialectical framework, the new dialectical framework, the big difficulty is to maintain the possibility of being outside while prescribing something that concerns the inside. There is then a sort of topological difficulty in the development of politics today, namely the relation between the outside and the inside. Because the state is always inviting you inside and asking that you not be outside. It's the most important point for the state, that everybody will be inside, inside the power, inside the law, and so on. I have had many very concrete experiences of this. Suppose, for instance, I shall go with some workers to discuss matters with some minister or other because the state refuses their regularization, refuses to give them papers to live as everybody. And always, this state representative in the office will ask, "Who are you?" And we always answer, "We are a political organization which is constructed by people." And the reply is always, "Okay, but who are you?" The problem is simple. For the state, and it's the general law of the power, for the state, to be somebody is to be inside the state. Otherwise, you cannot be heard at all. So there are two possible outcomes. Either finally, there is a discussion and some political results, or else there is no room for discussion because we are nobody. It is once more the precise question of affirmation. How can we be somebody without being on the inside? We must affirm first our existence, our principles, our action, always from outside. And finally, we can say to the man in the state office that we are exactly who we are, that the creation of something outside is a fact, and we must impose this affirmative existence to the question of the state. And it is no question of possible negation. The negation is without any any strength. The fact is we must affirm our existence in face-to-face to the state. I know that some critics of all that, and of my thinking too, we want to represent possibilities of a complete transformation, object that all that is too outside the real process, too outside. So all that cannot be an active game in the immanent and concrete world. And so that finally we must be inside in some sense. And it was the point of the old dialectics, because negation was immanent. So negation was active inside first. And we create the new affirmation by negativity. If first we have affirmation, we must be outside the state. Okay, but the objection is if we are absolutely outside the state, we cannot have any strength, finally. And I disagree with this sort of objection because I think that this objection finally denies the necessity of a new conception of affirmative dialectics. It's a realistic objection, as very often in politics, oh, what you say is very beautiful, but it's not real. Okay. Certainly, it's not real. But what is the definition of the real? Precisely, the question of a new affirmation is the question of a new definition of the real. So we cannot accept the consideration that it's not real without a first discussion concerning what is real. What is the real? And it's really the point. If I can organize something outside the state, it's real. Okay. It's real to be outside the state. And if you say it's not real, you are saying that is real only all that is inside the state. That is precisely the return to the old form of political negativity. I know, naturally, that event comes first, that the reality of action comes first. Without French Revolution, without action of workers, without the real and concrete movement of the Parisian proletariat, Marx certainly would never have created this concept of proletariat, this political concept of proletariat. The movement is not from the concept of proletariat to the proletarian movement. The real becoming is from the revolt of workers to the new proposition. I accept to say all that. So finally, the true discussion is not at all about the concrete analysis of global society, but really about our relation to the state. That is the point. The real question is whether today the political determination is to be outside or inside the state. And the fundamental idea is to be in the new affirmative dialectical framework, you must be outside the state. Because inside the state, you are precisely in the negative figure of opposition. And to be in opposition is not a new figure, is not a creative political position. If you are enclosed inside the state, even in a negative figure, that the figure of opposition, finally, the negativity, the appearance of negativity comes first. And so we abandon the idea of an affirmative dialectics. To finish, I want to insist on the fact that the new logical framework is not only a vision of politics, or even a vision of some particular practices, it prescribes much more generally a sort of anthropology, a new definition of mankind. First, I think we are animals, all of us. I speak at this level of human animals. And by contrast to all classical humanism, I put in this definition of animals a lot of things. ultimately, human animal encompasses practically all our concrete existence as such, without anything else and without any supplement. And I really think that capitalist anthropology is the conviction that fundamentally humanity is nothing else but self-interested animals. It's a very important point. I think we have to do some propaganda on this point. Modern capitalism is always speaking of human rights, democracy, freedom, and so on. But in fact, we can see concretely that under all these names, we find nothing else but human animals with interests who have to be happy with products. We have to search the good life in the big market. What the capitalist world names a subject or a citizen is something like animals in front of the market and nothing else. And this is really its definition of the human. It's only with this definition of the human being that capitalism can work. Animals with interests. And in this definition, we have, in fact, a hierarchy. It's not at all equality. At the bottom, we are the poor. We are before the market, as everybody, but without means. And at the top of which are the rich, we are also before the market, but we have far greater means. And the protection of all that is really nothing else but capitalist anthropology, which is always saying that this form of humanity is the true form of humanity, that there cannot exist another form of the collective existence. And the state, all the democratic states of the world, are also the organization of the protection of this vision of collective existence. The possibility to be something else than animals is the question and is really the becoming subject of a human animal. The becoming subject not is the abstract sense of capitalist anthropology, citizen, subject, human rights, and so on. How a human animal can become a subject? It's by the incorporation of a new body, which is something else that being in front of the market. That you become something like a subject by being precisely something else, like animal in front of the market. And it's a process of becoming subject for human animal, and it's an infinite process. Infinite is a name for this process because when we have this kind of incorporation in a new subject, that is, incorporation by affirmation of a new possibility, by the beginning of affirmation of a new possibility, we create the possibility of infinite consequences. The consequences are, by principle, infinite. The new possibility has always infinite consequences. So we can say that human rights, in the sense of rights that are the subject's rights, are in fact the right of the infinite. And it's very important to understand that the vision of the humanity by capitalism is under the law of finitude. There is no infinite possibility, because the infinite possibility would be something else than repetition. But the law of the market is circulation and repetition. And so it's the law of finitude which is imposed in the very vision of human animals as such. So human rights, rights that are really subject rights, are the right of the infinite. And it's Jean-François Lyotard which has for the first time written this formula in this most important book, Le Différent, où Jean-François Lyotard writes that the true formula is not human rights, but rights of the infinite. And I assume this formula of Lyotard. And after that, we can say some things concerning the anthropological question. I propose to say that the question of mankind, the question, the fundamental anthropological question is, what exactly is the singularity of mankind, the singularity of human beings? We know that today there exists a species of human animals defined by their inclusion in the global market. Alors, in contrast, we can name humanity the capacity of becoming the subject to an event, to something that happens, and not only to something which is. The capacity of accepting the possibility of an incorporation in a new subjective body. The capacity of drawing its practical consequences in the situation of incorporation, which itself is the becoming of the new subject. And in the becoming of the subject, beyond the support of all that which is one or some human animals, there is something infinite, a new creation of something infinite. And the name of this infinite something is for me truth. And so we can define humanity by the capacity of everybody to be an active part of a creation of a new truth. A new truth in the field of political action, artistical creation, and finally a new truth in common life too. So we can say that the incorporation of the subject is the incorporation of some human animals to something like the process of truth. And that is the global field of what we can name humanity or human beings in the context of affirmative dialectics. I agree ultimately with the young Marx on one point. It's only in the successive creation of new forms of subjects that there is something like a generic humanity, a true humanity, which is not under the law of finitude. Because a generic humanity is by necessity an infinite humanity. It's the same thing. And the human animal in front of the market is under the law of finitude of interests and is not at all generic. It is absolutely particular. All that is like a new hypothesis about the subject. And it's also a new hypothesis about human life, about what it means for humans to live, and not only to exist. In my book, Logic of the World, I oppose human rights in their ordinary meaning, the meaning in the direction of finitude, to the right of the infinite, by opposing what I name democratic materialism to the project of dialectical materialism. Dialectical materialism, it's a possible name for affirmative dialectics. What makes these forms of materialism opposed are their respective understandings of human life. Because at the end, the point is human life for a philosopher. The only very important point is human life, after all. So it's two completely different understandings of what is human life. Either it's the proposition of democratic materialism. Either there is nothing but language and bodies, and or there is a third term. Either there is only the constitution of animals, human animals, in front of the big market. Either there is something else. Something else like the production of truth that cut through the hegemony of our animal existence. The title of the conclusion of Logic of the World is What is to Live? And it's clearly the final question of anthropology. Two completely different conceptions of human life. The first reduces human life to common animal life. Satisfaction of all natural desires, happiness, security, and so on. The second one is what we are speaking of, the context of affirmative dialectics. Human life must be identified to the incorporation to a truth body. So a human being is properly living only when he or she is the agent of a passage from particularity to universality, from local process to genericity, from a singular world to an eternal truth. For all that, we must create progressively a new world, a world which is not the world of the big market. So the question of the real life of human bodies is also a question of the future. But it's not because it is the question of the future that we cannot affirm this vision. Because as I was saying at the beginning, we must precisely affirm the future before the present, to do something, to create something. This second conception is a bit heroic one. And we know that many philosophers affirm that the time of heroism is past, that we must only affirm ordinary languages, ordinary lives, ordinary and modest creations, and so on. That is the real. And naturally, to be heroic is always to propose something which is a bit beyond the real. But it's the price to pay for have something else than the human animal in front of the market. But maybe, after all, Althusser was right to to affirm that philosophy has no history. It was a paradoxical affirmation for a Marxist. Strange affirmation for a Marxist. Very interesting affirmation. Philosophy was a unique form of thinking without history. Maybe it was right. The fact that an idea is old is not, for a philosopher, an objection against this idea. And so, if an idea is a heroic one, it's not an objection against this idea, even if we are in a non-heroic world. In any case, even if this conception is a bit heroic one, I must affirm before you it's mine. And certainly, I am too old to change my mind on this point. Thank you.